So I'll be starting with the dot product, or what we call as the scalar product. Okay. You've already been using dot product in your physics for calculating the work done by a force which creates a displacement in a body in a certain direction. Okay. So dot product of two vectors. Okay. First of all, please understand here, for finding the dot product, both of them should be vectors. When you multiply a scalar with a vector, that is called the scalar multiplication. That is not called scalar product. Are you getting my point? This is a wrong use of word that many people do. Well, let's say you multiply a vector quantity with 5. You're doing a scalar multiplication of A with 5. You don't say I'm doing a scalar product with 5. No. Scalar product or dot product is a reserved word that we use for doing such kind of an operation on two vectors, right? So what does this operation actually do? So this operation is basically supposed to give the product of magnitude of one of the vectors, let's say magnitude of vector A, into projection of B in the direction of A. Okay. Or let me write it in capitals, or it's the magnitude of B into, this is your normal into projection of A in the direction of B. Now, what is magnitude? Everybody knows. But what is projection of a vector in the direction of some other vector? That is very important. So first, let me explain that. Then I will come back to this expression once again. Yes, Aditya will take those questions. Don't worry. Vector is not going to get over very soon. It has got a lot of concepts into it. And while we are doing other topics in vectors, we'll be revisiting our concept of addition of vectors, etc. Prakul will talk about that. Okay, now what is the projection of, let me just take in general here. What is the meaning of projection of a vector, let's say P, in direction of Q? Okay. So it just means that, let's say this is my vector P. Okay. This is a vector P. Okay. And there's another vector. Let me just make it in yellow color. Let's say this is another vector. This is your vector Q. Okay. I want to know the projection of P in the direction of Q. So what does it mean? It means that if I start dropping perpendiculars from every point of P onto Q. Okay. So I'll just, you know, dot, dot, dot. I'll just go to the last point. Okay. This length, which I'm showing with white here, this length is called the projection of P on Q. Okay. It's a scalar number. It's a scalar quantity. So projection is a scalar quantity. Okay. So this is nothing but as if you have lit a light source over here, and that light source is casting image of this vector P onto Q. Okay. So this is called the projection of P in direction of Q. Is that idea clear? Okay. So from every point, if you draw perpendicular onto the other vector Q here, so that lines that will be created like an image or a shadow, that will be called the projection. Okay. Now coming back to this, what is the projection of B in the direction of A, and what is the product with the magnitude of A? That is, what is your dot product? So let's take a diagram over here. Let's say there is a vector A. Okay. And there is another vector B. Okay. I'll just make them co-initial. Need not be co-initial, by the way. So let's say this is vector A, this is vector B. Okay. So let's say this angle is theta. I hope everybody knows that the angle between two vectors is the shortest angle between them when the vectors have been made co-initial. Correct. So if I start dropping perpendiculars, now please note I have made them co-initial. So there's no point dropping a perpendicular from that point to itself. Okay. So this length, which I'm showing with a zigzag, that length is called the projection of B on A. So what will be this zigzag length? As per the diagram, if this is theta and this length, all of you can figure out that this length is mod of the vector B. So that would be mod B cos theta, correct? So here magnitude of A multiplied with mod of B cos theta, which is nothing but mod AB, mod A mod B cos theta, that would become the dot product. Okay. In a similar way, if I say what is the projection of A on B? So what you will do, you will just extend this further. That means you will just show the support of that vector. So I hope everybody knows what's the support of a vector. So support of a vector is the infinite line from which that vector has been carved out. Okay. And you drop again perpendiculars from every point of this vector A onto B. Then this length will be called as the projection of B, sorry, projection of A in the direction of B. And that length would be mod A cos theta. As you can see, this angle will be theta. This is your hypotenuse and the base will be mod A cos theta. So as per the second formula, the expression for the dot product would be mod B mod A cos theta. So it doesn't make any difference. So either of the two is going to give you the answer. So whether you take the projection of the force in the direction of the displacement and multiply it with the magnitude of the displacement, or you take the projection of the displacement in the direction of the force and multiply it with the magnitude of the force, both of them ultimately leads to the work done by the force. Is it fine? So this dot product was required from physical perspective. So this is this entire scenario was given a small name as a dot product, so that when it is, when something is used very commonly, we give them an abbreviation, right? So when they say dot product, it is magnitude of A into magnitude of the other vector in the direction of that given vector. Is it fine? Any question with respect to what is dot product of two vectors? Any questions? Clear. Okay, so let's take some properties of the dot product. I've already, I think, kept a snapshot so that we don't have to write too much. Okay, we'll take this snapshot. Okay, can you all see the screen? Can you all read this, or is it too small? Is it legible? Readable, no? Okay. I have kept it. I have taken a snapshot because I wanted to save time. Okay. I normally love to write, but I thought that most of you would be asking me to leave you early. So, okay. So first thing is dot product is commutative. So as you can see, A dot B, B dot A, there is no difference between it. You're already aware of it. So it's more or less like a revision of whatever you have learned in physics. So dot product is commutative. Dot product is distributive over addition and subtraction. So if you do A dot B plus C, it is A dot B, A dot C. You can change the order also in which it is written. Okay. So it is called left distributivity because your vector that you are taking is on the left of B plus C. Similarly, you can also have B plus C dot A. So it will give you B dot A plus C dot A, and both of them will be equal. Hence, distributive property will hold true. If A and B are perpendicular, now this is something which needs a small, you know, discussion here. See, A dot B, if it is positive and A and B are non-zero vectors. Okay, so let's say A and B are non-zero vectors. Non-zero vectors mean they're not zero vectors. And if A dot B is positive, it means the angle between A and B, the angle between A and B is acute. Okay, angle between A and B is acute. And if A dot B is zero, that means the angle between A and B, the angle between A and B, let me write it like this, A and B is 90 degrees, means they are perpendicular. Okay. And if A dot B is negative, that means the angle between A and B is obtuse. Okay. That means if the work done by a force on a particle is negative, it means the displacement of the body with respect to the force is in the opposite direction. I mean, almost, let's say if I'm pushing a wall, okay, and I get pushed by it in turn. So I applied a force, but the displacement was opposite to the direction of a force. So there's a negative work done by me. In fact, the wall did a work on me. Okay. So in this case, the dot product would be negative. Okay. So that is what has been explained over here. So that is why if A dot B is zero, it means the two vectors are perpendicular. So dot product is one of the safest means to find the angle between two vectors also. So by the definition of the dot product, we know that dot product is mod A mod B cos theta. So cos theta is mod A, sorry, A dot B by mod A mod B. Okay. So normally to find the angle between two vectors, we use the dot product. Okay. Between two vectors. Now, many people say, sir, we could find angle also by using cross product, isn't it? Because you have already done it in physics that mod of A cross B is mod A mod B sine theta. But in that case, there will be an issue. The reason is if there is an angle which is lying in a first quadrant and second quadrant, which are supplementary of each other, sine theta gives the same value for both of them. For example, sine 30, sine 150, same thing. Sine 45, sine 135, same value. So if the angle between two vector is, let's say, 30 degree, and if you use your cross product, in cross product, you will get sine theta as a half. So you will not come to know whether it is actually 30 degree or 150 degree. But cos theta will actually help you make that distinction whether it is 30 or 150, because cos 30 will be positive. Let's say positive root 3/2, and cos 150 will be negative root 3/2. So the change in the sign will be indicating you that there is that angle is obtuse in nature. Therefore, dot product is preferred for finding the angle between two vectors, not the cross product. Are you getting my point? So this could be a question to you in a KVPY interview kind of a thing. Why dot product is preferred, not cross product? Okay. So if two vectors are perpendicular, their dot product is zero. So I dot j, j dot I, j dot k, k dot j, k dot I dot k, they're all zero. So this is very obvious to everybody. Okay. This is one of the most important properties I have seen in dot product. A dot A is mod A square, even though it seems to be very trivial, but one of the very important mechanism to solve many questions related to dot product. So I dot I, J dot J, K dot K, they will all be one. So very useful. These two are very useful when you are finding the dot product of two vectors, which have been resolved into I, J, K components. I think Kiran sir would have also covered resolution of vectors in two dimension, three dimension. Okay. So when you write your vectors in terms of I, J and K, and then you are, you know, taking a dot product of two vectors, then these relations will always be helpful to you in finding your end result. Some properties which are, you know, slightly trivial ones. If you have multiplied a vector with a scalar quantity, that means scale, but vector A is, you know, multiplied, scalar multiplied with M, then the dot product with B is as good as M into A dot B or A dot MB, doesn't make a difference. So the presence of a scalar quantity along with a vector does not influence much. It can always be taken out and the dot product can be performed and multiplied back with the scalar. Okay. So these two properties are quite trivial. I think this is also very trivial. Yeah. So these all properties that you see, you'll keep on using these, you know, in your bigger problem solving. For example, if somebody says mod A plus B square, let me just take a space over here. Mod A plus B square. So if you see mod A plus B square, if you recall that mod A square is A dot A. So you can write this as A plus B dot A plus B. Okay. So this is going to give you A dot A, which is mod A square, B dot B, which is mod B square. And you'll end up getting A dot B, B dot A. A dot B, B dot A are equal to each other because, as you know, they are commutative. So this gives you this particular expression, okay, 2A dot B. Okay, this is going to be useful in proving certain type of questions, which we'll be taking a little later on. Okay. Similarly, you can also prove all these things. A, in fact, there is a small sign missing here. Yeah. So A minus B. Achha, many times they write just A square. A square is as good as saying A dot A, and it is as good as saying mod A square. So here, the term which I have written, this could also be written sometimes as A square by certain books. Don't get confused. A square just means A dot A, or it just means mod A square. So all these are same equivalent expressions. Okay. So all these things can be very easily proved. Okay, so can somebody prove that if mod A plus B is mod A plus mod B, how is A parallel to B? Can somebody prove this? If mod A plus B is mod A mod B, prove that A is parallel to B. Very simple question. Just write it done if you're done. Done. Anusha is done. Okay, so prove this as of now and prove the F1 also as of now. Done. So to prove D, very simple. You just square both the sides. So mod A plus B square will be mod A mod B square. So this is just now we have written the result of it. Mod A square mod B square 2A dot B. And this is also mod A square mod B square 2 mod A mod B. Okay. So a lot of things will get canceled off. Okay. So you'll end up getting A dot B is equal to mod A mod B. Clearly meaning that mod A mod B cos theta is equal to mod A mod B. So they will get canceled. So cos theta is a 1. Okay. So theta is 0 degree, which means the two vectors are parallel to each other. The two vectors are parallel to each other. F1 also done. Do I need to do F1 or should I move on to the questions? We can move on. Okay. Okay. Yeah, so let me begin with this question. If A, B, C are mutually perpendicular vectors of equal magnitude, find the angle between the vectors A and A plus B plus C. Okay, Kshitij. Okay, I'm getting Anusha's answer, Shitij's answer. Both have given different answers. However, okay, if you see this situation, compare this situation as if there is a cube. Ayo. At least they like a cube. Okay. So they have given that A, B, C are of equal magnitudes, and not only that, they are perpendicular to each other also. Okay. So you can take this vector to be A, you can take this vector to be B, and you can take this vector to be C. Okay? Yes or no? So A plus B plus C will basically be a vector which is connecting this end to this diagonal. Correct? So this will be A plus B plus C. The question is, what is the angle between this diagonal and the vector A? Okay? Now, if you see, you actually don't need this ABC. You can deal with coordinates as well. Okay. So think as if this is a cube of unit dimension. Okay. So this point is 1, 1, 1. Correct. So what is the angle made by, let's say, O, and I'll call this point as P. What is the angle made by OP with, let's say, the positive, this is your x-axis, positive x-axis. Okay. In short, they're asking you, they're asking you the angle between two vectors, which is one is I, J, K, okay? And the other vector is I. What is the angle between these two vectors? Okay. So what is the angle? So cos theta is dot product of these two. I'm writing it initially because this is the first class on this topic. Divided by their respective magnitude. Okay. So this will become 1. And magnitude of this is root 3. Magnitude of this is 1. So theta is going to be, theta is going to be cos inverse of 1 by root 3. Theta is going to be cos inverse of 1 by root 3. Now, let us say I don't want to use this cube and all. Then how do I solve this question? Okay. Even that is not difficult actually. So if you see, A and A plus B plus C, if you want to find out the angle, let's say the angle is cos of, let's say the angle is theta. So cos theta will be dot product of these two by magnitude of these two. Correct? Now to find the magnitude of A plus B plus C, this part. Okay, let me do a small activity here. This square will be what? If you see, this square will be A plus B plus C dot A plus B plus C. Okay. So that is going to give you mod A square, mod B square, mod C square, and the dot product of every other vector with the other one will be 0. So ideally it should be 2A dot B. Let me write it down. 2A dot B, 2B dot C, and 2B dot B dot, 2B dot C plus 2C dot A, and they will all start becoming 0, 0, 0 because they are mutually perpendicular. Okay. So let's say each one of them is lambda. So mod of A, mod of B, mod of C, each one of them is, let's say, lambda. So this is going to be 3 lambda square. That is nothing but mod A plus B plus C is going to be root 3 lambda. So here A dot A will be lambda square. This is lambda and this is root 3 lambda. So they will get cancelled off. So theta would be cos inverse of 1 by root 3. Easy. This way also could be used to figure it out. Okay. Acha, one important thing which I forgot to tell you in the properties, I should have written it. Okay. One important inequality is basically related to the fact that cos theta is equal to A dot B by mod A mod B. Okay. So all of you, please pay attention here. cos theta is a quantity less than 1, less than equal to 1. So A dot B will be less than equal to mod A mod B. Okay, so many times we write this expression like this. A dot B square is less than equal to mod A square mod B square. Okay, and let us say A is made up of A1i, A2j, A3k. Okay, and B is made up of B1i, B2j, B3k. Okay, then A dot B is nothing but summation AI BI whole square. Summation, or you can just write it as summation A1B1 whole square. Am I right? So left hand side is this, and right hand side is summation A square summation B1 square. Okay. So this is a very important inequality in the field of mathematics. I think people who are prepared for RMO, PRMO would already be knowing that. What is the name? What is the name? Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Please note it down. Some questions in JEE has also been asked on the same. Is it fine? Note it down. So many times there are some questions which you will not even realize that, oh, it is based on Cauchy-Schwarz. Okay. And that will be helpful. So how did you get the formula? I didn't understand. Which formula? This formula. Cauchy-Schwarz. See, cos theta is less than 1, no? Less than equal to 1. So I took this to the other side. Just focus on this part. Correct? I squared both the same, or for that matter, you can do it here itself. Cos square theta is this square, and that will be also less than 1. Oh, how did I get this? Okay. A dot B will be what, Anusha? What will be A dot B? Have you done dot product of two vectors resolved into two component in physics? What do you do? You just literally take their dot products. Okay, should I do it and show you? Because I was assuming that you have done it n number of times in physics. Huh, so you already know it. Correct? No. So when you take a dot product of this, you only end up getting A1, B1, A2, B2, and A3, B3. Correct? So can I say A dot B square will be square of this term? This term is abbreviated like summation A1, B1. So this is called summation A1, B1. Okay. If you want, I can write it in more detail. Let me write it in more detail if you want me to that. So it just says A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, B3 whole square is always less than equal to A1 square, A2 square, A3 square times B1 square, B2 square, B3 square. Okay. This is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. T2 inequality, yes. Many inequalities are interrelated. T2, and there is something called rearrangement inequality. They're all related to each other. Okay. Fine. So let's have another one now. Okay, let's take a simple question, which really would have done in physics also. Using vector method, prove that in any triangle, A square is equal to B square plus C square minus 2BC cos A, famously called as the cosine law. How do you prove this using vectors? Yeah, done. Okay. So fine. So let's do a simple activity here. Let me make a triangle. Okay. And you can assign any vector, any direction vector to this. Okay. So let's say I have A, B, C. Okay. Let's call this as vector A. Okay. Let's call this as vector B. And let's call this as vector C. By the way, the choice of the direction is completely arbitrary. Okay. You can put any direction you want. Okay. Now, in the present way I have shown it, you can see that A plus B plus C is a null vector, because they are cyclically closed. Okay. So from here, I can see B plus C is negative A. Okay. Let's do one thing. Let's write a mod on both the sides. So mod of negative A, and that is as good as mod A. Doesn't make any difference, because if you multiply a vector with a negative one, it just changes the direction. Doesn't change the magnitude. And let's say square both the sides. So when you square both the sides, it's as good as saying you're taking a dot product of B plus C with itself. And this is A dot A. So this is mod B square mod C square plus 2B dot C. And this is mod A square. Now remember, mod A, mod B, mod C are nothing but the side lengths. Okay, this is A. Mod B is nothing but B. Mod C is nothing but C. Okay, so this is B square, this is C square. And this is 2 mod A mod B cos of the angle between B and C, which I'm leaving as of now blank. Okay. Because I would like to ask you, what is the angle between vector B and vector C? What is the angle between vector B and vector C? No, it's pi minus A. Please note, angle between two vectors is defined when they have been made co-initial. So this is the angle between vector B and C, which is 180 degree minus A. Okay. So in this gap, I'll have to put 180 degree minus A. Don't write A. A is not the angle between B and C. Okay. It's pi minus A. So this will become B square plus C square minus 2BC cos A is equal to A square. And there you go. This is the proof that we wanted to do. Is it clear? Maybe asked in school exam or however. Okay. So please be careful about writing this proof. We'll take the next question immediately without much waste of time. Let's take another one. Can you prove the projection formula? A is equal to B cos C plus C cos B. Just say done if you're done. 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 Okay. We'll take the same figure. Okay. So we can do one simple activity here. We'll take A as negative B plus C. Okay. And then we'll take a dot product, with A on both the sides. Okay. On both sides. Okay. So what will happen? This will become A dot A. This will become minus A dot B. This will become minus A dot C. Okay. So A dot A is A square because it is mod A square. So mod A is A actually. Okay. Now this is going to be minus A B cos of the angle between A and B. So A and B, if you see the cos of the angle is cos 180 degree minus C, right? Because this is the angle between A and B, which is 180 degree minus C. Okay. So angle between two vectors is always the smallest angle between them when they have been made co-initial. Similarly, this will be minus A C cos 180 degree minus B. Okay. This is the angle between. Fine. So this is going to be A square minus AB cos 180 minus C is minus cos C. So it will become AB cos C. And this will become AC cos B. Drop the factor of A. So A becomes B cos C plus C cos B. Done. Any questions? Oh, sorry, I didn't see your message, Anusha. Clear? Okay. Anyways, I mean, there are so many ways to do it. Express A as sum of two vectors such that one is parallel to this vector and the other is perpendicular to the same vector. Yes. Okay, Shitish, anybody else? See, these are all just warm-up problems. So we are yet to start with the, you know, typical questions that are asked on this topic. 30 seconds, okay. Okay, Kinshuk. Okay, so since alpha is parallel to b, I can say alpha is lambda 3i plus k. Can I say that? Lambda being some scalar quantity. So what I'll do now, I'll write beta as a minus alpha, which is nothing but 5i minus 2j plus 5k minus alpha. Minus alpha is minus 3 lambda I minus lambda k. In short, it becomes 5 minus 3 lambda I, and it will become plus j minus 2 plus, sorry, minus 2 minus lambda. Okay. No, j will not be affected. Sorry, j will be not affected. Only k will be affected. So this will be k, not j. Okay. So j will remain minus 2j, and this will become k cap. Okay. Now this vector is perpendicular to B. So that means beta dot B should be zero, because beta is perpendicular to B. That means this dot product with B vector. So B vector is 3i plus k. So this dot product with 3i plus k. So I'm just writing it directly, the result. So 3 into 5 minus 3 lambda plus 1 into this. So minus 2 minus lambda, this should be equal to 0. In other words, 13, and this is going to be minus 10. Am I right? So lambda is going to be 13 by 10. Correct me if I'm wrong. Correct me if I have missed out any information. Do let me know. Oh, once again. That is 5 lambda. This is 5 minus lambda. Yeah, sorry about that. So that's going to be 15, 20 equal to 10 lambda. So lambda is 2. Is it fine? Everybody's getting that? Okay. Put it back over here. So when you put it back, your alpha becomes 6i plus 2k. Okay. And beta is going to be 5i minus 2j plus 5k. Minus 3i plus k into 2, or 6 times this, whatever. Okay. So that will give you minus I minus 2j and plus 3k. That's going to be your beta. Any questions, any concerns with respect to alpha and beta value? This value and this value. Okay, good enough. Next, please copy down if you want to copy anything or ask anything, please do let me know. All right, so we'll move on. In a tetrahedron OABC, the edges are of length OA and BC are equal to AH, OB and AC are equal to B each, OC and AB are C each. If G1 and G2 be the centroid of ABC and AOC, and OG1 is perpendicular to BG2, then find the value of a square plus c square by b square. I'll put the poll also on for this. This length is A. BC length is, okay. So you can call this length as position vector A, magnitude of, you can say magnitude of A is A. This is B, and this is C. All right, so I've got four responses so far. Last minute I can give you, it's almost 3.5 minutes. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so I could see just 14 of you have responded to this question. Most of you have said option number B. Okay, Prakul, which option did you choose? Prakul, you're there? Okay, you chose B. Okay, that's the safe answer to say. Okay, first of all, if you realize that I'm calling this vector as A, that means position vector of A is A, position vector of B is B, position vector of C is C. Okay. They have mentioned that G1 is the centroid of ABC. So position vector of G1 will be position vector of ABC by 3. Okay. I hope you have done the concept of position vector. Just like we do it for coordinates, the same role is being played by position vectors in vector. Okay. So just like when you are finding the centroid of a triangle, whose vertices are specified, what do? You add all the x coordinates divided by 3. You add all the y coordinates divided by 3. The same thing is done in one shot by vectors if you know the position vector of the vertices. Okay. Okay. Let me also ask you, what is the position vector of G2? That means OG2. OG2, G2 is the centroid of the triangle AOC. Okay. AOC or OAC, whatever you call it, the position vector of the centroid will be A plus C by 3, correct? They're asking BG2 vector. BG2 is position vector of G2 minus position vector of B, isn't it? So it's A plus C by 3 minus B. That's nothing but A plus C minus 3B by 3. Now, as per the given question, these two are perpendicular. Okay, these two guys are perpendicular. Correct? So if these two are perpendicular, I can say A plus B plus C by 3 dot A minus 3B plus C by 3, this should be 0. Okay. That clearly means, I'm just doing fast forward here. That clearly means A square minus 3B square plus C square. And this will give you 3A dot B. So minus 2A dot B, if I'm not mistaken. And it will give you A dot C, 2A dot C. Correct? And B dot C will be minus 3B dot C minus 2B dot C. Okay, so this will give you 0. Correct? Now, I have still not used, let me call it as 1 for the timing. I have still not used the fact that OA is equal to, or mod OA is equal to mod BC. And that is equal to A. I have not used this 3 information yet. How did you got OG2? OG2 is the position vector of G2. That is the centroid of the triangle. Centroid of the triangle is what? Centroid of the triangle is sum of all the position vectors of the vertices by 3. So O is 0 because O is the reference vector for me. Right? So 0 plus A plus C by 3. Got it, Ruchita? Okay. So yes, so I've still not used the fact that BC is equal to A. Now BC is what? Position vector of C minus position vector of B. This is equal to A. This is given to me. Similarly, AC is also B. So C minus A is given to me as B. Okay, let's call it as 2. And AB is given to me as C. So mod of B minus A is C. Is it fine? Any questions here? Okay. So let's square here both the sides. So if you square here both the sides, okay, what does it give us? C square plus B square minus 2B dot C is equal to A square. Right? So at least we now know that negative 2B dot C is A square minus B square minus C square. So I could use it over here. You see here, minus 2B dot C is here. So I'll use that over here. Okay. So let me just box it for the time being. Okay. Let's use the second piece of information. So if I square this also, I'll get c square plus a square minus 2a dot c is equal to b square. So 2a dot c is going to be a square minus b square plus c square. So this is another piece of important information for me because I can use it over here. Is it not? Okay. Next, let's use the third piece of information. This gives me b square plus a square minus 2a dot b is equal to c square. In short, I got minus 2a dot b as negative a square, negative b square plus c square. So this is another piece of information useful for us. Let's put these three square boxed information in place of these gentlemen over here in one. So when I do that, I'll write here itself. So it gets a square minus 3b square plus c square minus 2a dot b will be minus 2a dot b will be minus a square minus b square plus c square. 2a dot c will be a square minus b square plus c square. And minus 2b dot c will be a square minus b square minus c square. This is given to me as 0. So now let us start collecting our a square terms. So how many a square terms will be there? This and this will get cancelled. So 2 a square term will be left. Okay. How many b squares? Minus 4 b square minus 6 b square. Oh, by the way, cancellation doesn't mean I'm actually canceling it. Cancellation just means I'm taking care of those terms. So here also gone, and this is 2c square. Okay. In short, I can see that a square plus c square is 3b square. That means a square plus c square by b square is going to be 3. So the answer to this question is option number B. Is it fine? Any question? Anybody who figured out a shorter way to do it? Other than this, do let me know. Angle between the vectors same. Which vectors? A, B, C? Are you finding it the same? I mean, is there any information which says it is same? Or did you figure out it is the same? Because I don't see such kind of thing. No, there's no such information that tells us. Okay. All right. Can we go to the next question? Let's take another one. Okay, let's take this one. Poll is on. Four vectors A, B, C, and X satisfy the relation A dot X. Now, this is scalar multiplication. See, A dot X times B, scalar multiplication, is equal to C plus X. B dot A is not equal to 1. Find the value of X in terms of A, B, and C. So, which of the following expression is your expression for the vector X, which you need. By a magnitude, full vector. What? Without direction, what is the meaning of a vector? No meaning of vector without direction. X vector. How is it a scalar multiplication? A dot x is a scalar quantity. So it's like lambda. Ruchita, we can go back to that question after this. Okay. Really, Jatish? Okay, I can give you 30 more seconds because I have already given you 4.5 minutes, but I could see only 8 of you have answered this question. That's just 17% of the population attending the class. Guys, have you done vectors in physics? You have done vectors in school also, right? Okay. I was just taking the confirmation. School you have not done. What about Rajaji Nagar and Kor Mangla? Not done. Kor Mangla it is done. Okay. See, there is a, okay, let me stop the poll first of all. If you want to vote, you can vote it. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so 17 of you seem to be active. So most of you have gone with option number B. It's not because you solved it and got B. It's because B seems to be the safest option to choose. I don't know why. Got B for Bajrangbali or something like that. Okay, B seems to be the favorite of people who guess. See here, there is already a dot x over here, and there is an x sitting over here. So what I'll do here is I will take dot product with a on both the sides. Okay, so I'll take dot product with a on both the sides. Okay, So when I do that, I get a dot x times a dot b. Please note that this is just as two scalar numbers multiplied. And this is a dot c, a dot x. Okay. Bring this number to the other side. You'll end up getting a dot x and you get a dot b minus 1 equal to a dot c. Correct? So a dot x becomes a dot c upon, okay. Now put this back in the given expression itself, which was provided to you. So a dot x into b, instead of that, I will write a dot c by a dot b minus 1. Now, do you now understand why they had given this information that a dot b is not 1? Because now you're getting a dot b minus 1 in the denominator. So everything provided to you in the question is provided for a reason, right? So this times b vector is c plus x. And there you go. You can easily make x the subject of the formula. So it's a dot c by a dot b minus 1 times b minus c. Okay. So does it match with anything? Yes, option A it matches. Why not? If you take the LCM, it matches with option A. So it's A dot C times B minus C times A dot B minus 1. Okay. So it matches with option A. That means majority people got it wrong because of the guesswork. Only 4 people got it right. Yes. Put X perpendicular to A. Okay. If X is perpendicular to A, X becomes negative C. Okay. And you put A dot B. Okay. And you take the dot product and see which option is giving you. Okay, take a dot product with C and see which option is satisfying that. Good. That's a great idea, Shitish. Okay. Is it fine? By the way, later on, we'll talk about this aspect a little more. This is basically called solving for a vector. So it is a kind of a vector equation. So we'll talk more about it under vector equation. See, what he did was he took A dot X to be 0. Okay. He got X as negative C. Correct. And with that, he took a dot product. So see, if you see this, all of these options are representing X, right? So here, if you take dot product with A and put 0 and put all your A dot C's also as 0, because for him, X has come out to be negative C. Okay. So he checked which of them gave 0. Only option 1 gave 0. Yeah. A dot C will be 0, right? So that will give you only negative C. Yeah, that also you don't need to do. Correct. So he's saying that if A dot C is 0, this will go for a toss. You don't have to do this also. So A dot C will be 0. This will become a 0. And this term and this term will get canceled, giving you X as minus C, which is what he had actually got by assuming X is perpendicular to A. Right? So he has applied a lot of mind in doing scamming in this. Okay. Ha, that is scamming only. And he proudly claims that he has done it. Could you explain the first step of what my this thing or what Shitish did? I just took a dot product with A on both the sides. So this vector equation, I took a dot product with A on both the sides. Take dot product with A on both the sides. Okay. So when you take the dot product, remember this is a scalar quantity. Scalar quantity is taken out. Remember there was a property in that property list, which I told you, MA dot B is same as m a dot b. The same thing I did over here. And I brought this a dot x to the left side. I took that as common. So it'll become a dot b minus one. Okay. So I got a dot x like this. And I put this back in this given expression, the actual expression given to you in the question. Yes, I was trying to remove that a dot x thing. I was just trying to get only x in that expression so that I could easily make that as the subject of my formula. Oh, sorry. I think Ruchita wanted me to discuss something in the previous. Yes, Ruchita. How did I get 1, 2, and 3? See, 1, 2, and 3 says B's, mod BC is A. So I think you would have been already taught that if you know the position vector of end of two points, let's say this is PQ length. And somebody says this is position vector P, this is position vector of Q. Okay, so P is the position vector of P, small q is the position vector of Q. So what is PQ? PQ is Q minus P. So mod PQ will be what? Mod of this. That's exactly what I did when I was using the fact BC. Okay, BC vector mod is A, or length of BC vector is A. So BC vector is C minus B mod equal to A. And this is what I squared and I got this. From this part, it is clear, right? I think you only wanted me to tell about 1, 2, and 3. Okay. All right. So let's take this question. If you put the poll. Think how that 4PQ would have come and why they have squared the vector A. Think something. And there is an inequality also. So there are a lot of hints that question is giving you. You just have to grab that hint. Okay. 2 minutes, two people have responded. Okay, so we'll close in another 15, 20 seconds. Let's say half a minute. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. So most of you have said option number D. Let's check. See, for PQ term, etc., they start coming when you use this expression, something like this, or you can say a famous inequality that you have been using since beginning. So can I say this term, that is PX minus QY, can I say it will be mod PX plus QY square minus 4PQXY, PQ are constant. Yeah, PQX dot Y. Can I write it like this? Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. So now we already know that this should be greater than zero because it is mod of a vector and you're squaring it also. So it is greater than or equal to zero. Okay. And as per the given scenario, this term is an A. This term is a vector A. So this is mod A square. Correct. So mod A square minus 4PQ X dot Y is greater than or equal to zero. That means mod A square by 4PQ is greater than X dot Y. Correct. But my question seems to say something else. But my question says X dot Y is greater than or equal to mod A square by 4PQ. Okay. That means there is a contradiction here, which can only be resolved if X dot Y is equal to mod A square by 4PQ. Correct. So both are saying, things which are looking different from each other. So this contradiction can only be resolved when they are equal to each other, isn't it? If this is equal to zero, which means this is also equal to zero, then which clearly means that the matter comes all the way till mod PX minus QY is equal to zero, which clearly means that this is a zero vector. Correct. Which means X by Y is equal to P by Q. Correct. Or even mod X by mod Y. Oh, it's P, not. Oh, sorry. Yes. It's Q by P, not P by Q. Q by P. Okay. So this will also be Q by P only. That means X and Y vectors are actually collinear vectors. Okay. They are collinear vectors. So the ratio of their lengths will be just this proportionality Q by P only. So option number D is going to be right. Any questions? Okay. With this, we are now going to move towards without mod. No, they asked for the mod thing. No. Even with mod, they will be Q by P only. Equation just before this. You're talking about this equation? Yeah, what is the question, Kshitij? Oh, see, you can say X is Q by P times Y. That's what it says. Okay, you can treat this as if you are doing this operation. You can remove this if you want. Okay, so here of all, here if you take mod, it will become mod X is mod Q by P mod Y. So mod X by mod Y is equal to mod Q by P. But they have given PQ is positive, isn't it? If PQ is positive, then Q by P will also be positive. Am I right? Yes or no? So this is going to get rid of mod and it will become just Q by P. Now happy? All right. So we are now going to move towards the concept of vector product. Vector product, also called cross product. Okay. So unlike the scalar product, this is going to give you a vector quantity. Okay. So a vector quantity normally has a magnitude and has got a direction. Okay. It has magnitude as well as a direction. Okay. So let's figure out what is the magnitude and direction of A cross B. Most of you have already used this concept in your physics to find the moment of a force. Correct? Or current experienced or force experienced by a current carrying conductor, isn't it? So R cross F, torque or moment of a force, it is basically related to your concept of vector product. Okay. So magnitude of this vector A cross B, let me write it like this. This is your magnitude. Is basically nothing but it's the area of the triangle, area of the parallelogram, which is constructed using A and B as the adjacent sides. So this parallelogram area is given by your modulus of A cross B. Okay. So this area of the parallelogram is what is given by your mod of A cross B. So that is the magnitude part of A cross B. Okay. And what is the direction? Direction is basically obtained by using the right hand thumb rule. What is right hand thumb rule? If you take your right hand and stretch your fingers in the direction of A, okay, and then curl it naturally towards B. So please curl your fingers naturally towards B like this. If you keep it on A, so you keep the edge of your hand on A, curl it naturally towards B. Whatever direction of the thumb you are getting, that will be the direction of, that will be the direction of your A cross B. Okay. So if you call this as, let's say, eta cap, that will be the direction unit vector along this. So let's say I call this vector as eta cap. So eta cap is the unit vector in the direction of, okay, in the direction of A cross B, where eta cap is obtained by the direction shown by the thumb of your right hand when you curl your fingers, which were stretched in the direction of A, naturally towards B. The word naturally is very important. When many people will say, what, sir, if I stretch it backwards, then no, backward is not a natural curl. Natural curl will come in this way only. I hope you're able to see me on the camera. This is the natural curl of the finger. Is it fine? So this is nothing but this times eta cap. Eta cap is obtained by, so let's say unit vector. This is the unit vector in the direction of, in the direction of A cross B. And this unit vector happens to be perpendicular to the plane containing A and B. Okay. And obtained by using right hand thumb rule. obtained by using the right hand thumb rule. So right hand thumb rule, everybody has understood. So perpendicular could be two directions, up or down, but which direction will you take? Using the right hand thumb rule, so whichever vector you have written first, stretch your finger in the direction of that vector, curl it towards that vector which you have written next, which is B. The thumb direction, that perpendicular that is shown by the thumb, that will be, in that direction you take a unit vector, that will be your eta cap, or you can say that is the unit vector along A cross B. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? So both the things are clear. What is the magnitude of A cross B and what is the direction of A cross B? So magnitude is the area of the parallelogram, which is formed by A and B as the adjacent sides. And eta cap is the direction perpendicular to the plane containing A and B, but there could be two perpendiculars, one up and one down. So which one of the two? So the one which is obtained by your direction of the thumb when you are curling your finger naturally from the first vector to the second vector, which has been written in the cross product thing. Clear? So B cross A will have the same magnitude, but this time when you're curling your finger from B to A naturally, your thumb is going down the plane. Okay. So that direction will be exactly opposite. Same magnitude, exactly opposite. And that is why sometimes we say A cross B and B cross A are negatives of each other. In short, cross product of vectors are not commutative. So we'll be talking about those properties a little later on. But first, is everybody clear about what is A cross B, how it is obtained? It's a vector, first of all. It has a magnitude and a direction. What is the magnitude? That is clear. What is the direction? That is clear. Is it fine? Okay. Let's take some set of properties. Sir, always only two directions. No, it has only one direction. Why two directions? Who said there will be two directions? A vector has one direction only. If I have understood your question properly. A cross B will be when you stretch your finger along A and curl it towards B. That perpendicular which you get, that is A cross B. That direction. That is why I wrote it is perpendicular to the plane of A and B and obtained by using the right hand thumb rule. Perpendicular to a plane can be up the plane, down the plane also, right? But which of the two will be the answer? That is obtained, that is clarified by right hand thumb rule. So if I just say perpendicular, you will obviously question me, sir, which way, up way or down way? Perpendicular to the plane containing A and B, left right ka kaha sawal baithta hai yahan pe, batao zara. Kinshuk. Let's say this is the writing pad which I used to write. I hope you can see it. Okay. There are two vectors on it. Perpendicular ya to aisa hoga ya to aisa hoga. Why not up from B to A? I didn't get your question. B to A means what? Up from B to A means what? If you do B cross A, then it will be curl your finger towards in the direction of B, stretch your finger in the direction of B and roll it towards A. Then thumb will automatically go down the plane. Then it will go down the plane like this. Okay. So that will be a B cross A direction. That is how it has been defined, the cross product. Because we follow a right-handed coordinate system. This is how you generate a vector which is, you can say, linearly independent of A and B. In fact, your basic unit vector triad, I, J, K, also follow the same thing. I cross J is K actually, right? So K is a vector which is perpendicular to I and J, but it cannot be perpendicular in a random way. It can be, it is perpendicular following the right-handed coordinate system by default. Now again, if the question setter says, I am following a left-handed coordinate system, then A cross B will go down in this case. That means this will go down. In case the question setter says, we are following a right-handed coordinate system. Got it? Left-handed coordinate system. Sorry about it. Yeah. So we follow a right-handed coordinate system. That means when we fold, curl our finger from A to B, thumb direction is the direction of A cross B. If you follow left-handed coordinate system, you, when you curl your finger from A to B, you experience it yourself. Put your finger along A and curl towards B. Thumb is going down, no? So for a left-handed coordinate system, A cross B will go down. But that is against the convention that we normally follow. You know, in maths and science, we follow some conventions, right? If you redefine that convention, that, okay, no, I will take the direction from the pole opposite to the direction of light as positive, then your lens formula will change. Okay. Similarly, your all, formula of I cross J equal to K, everything will go for a toss. That will change. Okay. All right. So let's take some properties. And if I am not mistaken, I have the list of properties, I think. Yeah, I have the list. So I have saved your and my time by listing them down. By the way, let me tell you, in JEE Advanced, they had given one question in one of the cases that, assuming we are following a left-handed coordinate system, then they had asked to simplify some expression. So be aware of that. So left-handed coordinate system, you have to follow the left-hand thumb rule. Okay, properties of vector product. This is already, I told you that it is not commutative because they are opposite in direction, even though their magnitude is the same. So A cross B, B cross A are oppositely directed. Yes, this is very important. Vector product is not associative. Now, this is something which I will talk about in more details in VTP, vector triple product. Okay. So this is to be dealt in vector triple product. So let's not bother too much about it. Vector triple product. So just know for as of now that A cross B cross C is not the same as A cross B bracket cross C. Okay. We'll talk about it later. Just to tell you briefly now, A cross B cross C is a vector in the plane of B and C, while this is a vector in the plane of A and B. Okay. Next. Your M A cross B is same as M times A cross B. It is same as A cross MB. There's no difference. So the scalar quantity can always be pulled out. And it doesn't matter whether the scalar quantity is with A or with B. The scalar quantity can always be removed separately. Okay. Now see the distribution property of cross product over addition. Please note here you cannot play with the order. You cannot say A cross B plus C is B cross A plus C cross A. That will be wrong. The order has to be maintained. Can't switch the positions. Switching position is possible in dot product because dot product is anyways commutative, but here you cannot do that. Same if you're taking right-hand distributivity, please maintain the order. B will come first and then A, and plus C will come first and then A. Okay. Same goes with the subtraction also. Cross product of any vector with a null vector is a null vector. So A cross zero or zero cross A both will give you a null vector only. Okay. Apart from this, there are more properties which I'll pull in. I think this is, yeah. Okay. If vector product of two non-zero vectors is zero, it means the vectors are collinear. This is a very interesting property, very important one also. So if you find that two non-zero vectors cross product is coming out to be zero, it means the angle between them is either zero or 180 degree. That is why, see, you're trying to say that this is going to be zero, isn't it? So if A cross B is equal to null, their modulus is zero. And if you write it down, in fact, I will just prove it as of now because I have not written the proof for this, that it is mod A mod B sine theta. And if these two are non-zero, which clearly implies this has to be zero. So for that, theta has to be either 0 degree or 180 degrees. That means either they will be parallel or anti-parallel. Either they will be parallel or they will be anti-parallel. That means they will be collinear anyhow. That is what this fact number 8 says. So if the cross product of two vectors is a null vector, it means the two vectors are collinear vectors. Achha, now this information I had not given to you. So mod of A cross B is mod A mod B sine theta. How do you get this information? Very simple. I already told you that mod of A cross B gives you the area of this parallelogram, isn't it? And let's say this angle is theta. This angle is theta. So area of a parallelogram is what? Area of a parallelogram is base into height. So base is what? Mod A. Okay, so let's call this as a base. Base is mod A. And what is the height? Height is mod B sine theta. Okay, so mod B sine theta will act like a height. So this will give you the area of this parallelogram. And that is what we had learned was the magnitude of A cross B. Okay, or mod of A cross B. Please, very, very important thing to be kept in mind. I mean, I feel it is irrelevant to say, but many people, when I ask them, what is A cross B? They say mod A, mod B sine theta. A cross B is a vector. And you're answering the question of a vector with a scalar quantity. How is it possible? So mod of A cross B is mod A, mod B sine theta, not A cross B. A cross B is a vector. Its magnitude will be mod A, mod B sine theta, and it will have some direction also, which is given by the right-hand thumb rule, which I already told you. Okay, so don't make this mistake. It is a trivial thing to point out, but initially many people do that mistake. Okay, now see, furthermore properties, by the virtue of the fact that if two vectors are collinear, their cross product will be a null vector. That is why I cross I, J cross J and K cross K will be null vectors. Don't say zero, they are null vectors. Okay, zero vector, not zero scalar, zero vector. The ninth point is very important. The vector product of orthonormal triad of unit vectors I, J, K basically follow this particular rule. Please note this down. I cross J is K. J cross K is I, and K cross I is equal to J. But this is when you are following the right hand thumb rule or right hand coordinate system. If you were had you been following a left handed coordinate system, then what would happen? Then J cross I would have been K. K cross J would have been I, and I cross K would have been J. Understood? So that minor change will happen in the way you have written this formula. Okay. So I, J and K. Okay. They are in such a way normally that if you curl your finger naturally from I to J, it should give you K. Okay. If you curl your finger from J to K, see J to K, imagine curling your finger naturally from J to K, it gives you along I. Similarly, from K to I, it'll go towards inside the plane of the board, which is the direction of J. No, I, J, K is fixed. That position nobody can change. Right? But if you're following a left-handed system, then I cross J will go down. That is minus K. Assuming this is your IJK and you're following a left-handed coordinate system, then I cross J will be called as a minus K. That means J cross I will become K. Got it, Raghav? Is it fine? Any question, any concerns? Okay. Now, the 10th point is the Lagrange's identity. Okay. Actually, this Lagrange's identity is a very, very, you can say, special case of Lagrange's identity. Lagrange's identity is slightly broader. Let me write it first here. So Lagrange's identity is actually this. I will prove this later on, not right now, when I have done the vector triple product with you. Lagrange's identity says, okay, please note this down. We will prove this when I do. We'll prove it in vector triple product concept. Okay, wait for the proof. We'll talk about it. This is Lagrange's identity. Now, what this fellow has given here, he has actually taken C and D as A and B itself. Okay, so as a result, what has happened? In the 9th property, they have taken C as your A and B as your D, or you can say D as your B. Let's be consistent while writing. Yeah. So if you place it over here, it becomes A cross B dot A cross B. Okay. And this becomes A dot B. Then this becomes A dot B again. Okay. If I'm not mistaken. And this becomes B dot A. Have I missed out something? A dot D. Yeah, correct. And this is also B is B and D is, A dots A, it will become, A dot A, yeah. And this will become B dot B, yeah. So when you do that, it will become automatically mod A square, A dot B, B dot A, mod B square. So if you expand it, it automatically becomes mod A square, mod B square, minus A dot B the whole square, okay? This is the expression for A cross B dot A cross B. A cross B dot A cross B is actually mod A cross B the whole square. This is what they have mentioned here in property number 9. So mod A cross B whole square is mod A square mod B square minus A dot B square. And that's what we actually got. So what they have given is a special case of Lagrange's identity. Lagrange's identity. Is it fine? Now, this can anyways be proved without Lagrange's identity also. another way of looking at it is mod A cross B is what? Mod A cross B is mod A mod B into sine of theta, correct? So if you square it, this is what happens. And you may write sine square as 1 minus cos square. So if you expand it, it becomes mod A square mod B square minus mod A square mod B square cos square theta. Correct? No? Which is mod A square mod B square. And this is nothing but A dot B the whole square. And that is what they had given. Fine. But to prove this, we need to understand vector triple product. We cannot prove it now, as of now, because we have no idea about vector triple product officially. Is this fine? Any question, any concerns related to Lagrange's identity? Or any of these properties which I have mentioned? Okay. Now, how to calculate the cross product of two vectors when these vectors have already been given to me in a resolved format? This, most of you are already using it in physics. Okay. So let's say I want to calculate A cross B. Okay. What is the way to do it? Will I literally do the multiplication? Initially, yes, I will do it, but then I will tell you a shorter way to achieve that. So let's say you're doing cross product of this with this. Okay. So when you do cross product of A1 I cap with B1 I cap, please note that I cap cross I cap will be zero. So please do not do any kind of a multiplication of a unit vector with itself, cross multiplication, because that will waste your time, because anyways, you're going to get a null vector out of it. So no operations like A1 I cap cross B1 I cap, that will be zero vector. A2 J cap, B2 J cap, I will not do that because that will again give me a zero vector. Again, A3 K cap and B3 K cap. I will not do that operation. In fact, I will do operation of A1 I cap with B2 J cap. So A1 I cap, B2 J cap. What will it give me? A1 B2 K cap, right? So let me do one thing. Let me just make, I know that I'm going to get some expressions containing I, some expression containing J, some expression containing K. So let me make the compartment for them already. Okay. So for K, I will end up getting A1, B2, and please note that when this multiplies with this, you will get A2, B1 minus K cap. So that will give you minus A2, B1, correct? Correct me if I'm wrong, if I missed out anything with respect to how many ways you can get K cap expression. Okay. Now J cap will come when I and K get multiplied. So A1, B3, let me write it in white. A1, B3. Okay. And this I multiplies with this K. So that will give me minus A3, B1. Correct? In fact, other way around, no? This will be minus and this will be plus. Sorry. This will be minus and this will be plus. So it will be A3, B1 minus A1, B3. Yeah. So remember, I, J, K. So K into I or K cross I is plus J. Right? And I cross K is minus J. Yeah, so that there will be a minus in front of A1, B3, correct? Similarly, I cap will be obtained when J and K interact. So A2, B3, but remember A2, B3 will come along with J cross K. J cross K will be I, so it will be A2, B3. And the other one will be negative A3, B2. Okay, looking at this, it basically reminds me as if I have expanded a determinant whose first row is I, J, K. Second row is A1, A2, A3. Third row is B1, B2, B3. Because if you do this expansion of this determinant, you'll automatically realize that you get I cap A2, B3 minus A3, B2, which matches with this. Okay. Now I'm writing minus J cap for now, but I will just take the minus inside in some time. So minus J cap. So just hide this row, hide this column. A1, B3 minus A3, B1. Okay. Remember, if you put the minus inside, it will become A3, B1 minus A1, B3, like what I have written over here. Okay. Similarly, if you expand the K part, so K times A1, B2 minus A2, B1, which is your this part. Okay. So this and this become actually the same expressions. That is why when we are expanding the cross product of two vectors, which have been written in a resolved format, we can always use this determinant to do our work faster. Is it okay? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Time to take some questions on this cross product also. Let's take some questions. Okay, I'll start with a very easy question. Maybe something which can come in your school exams also. Okay, poll is on. If A is any vector, then A cross I square. By the way, A cross I square means A cross I mod square. As I told you, this is another way to write things. Oh, did I ask this in your school exam also? Okay, maybe I might have asked this. Done. Thirty seconds more I can give. Poll error. No, people are polling happily. What, here also you got it wrong? Eh? What? Yeah. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, most of you have said option number D for Delhi. Okay, let's check. Yeah, see, let's say I take A vector as A1i, A2j, A3k. Okay. If I take the cross product with I, okay, what I'll get? See, when I take cross product with I will not happen. So it'll be A2. It will be A2. J cross I. Right? J cross I will be minus K. Correct? And A3 K cross I will be J. So it will be A3J. Correct? So please be careful while you are choosing the sign. So J cross I is minus K, but K cross I is plus J. Okay. Now A cross I square means mod of this square. Mod of this square is just A2 square, A3 square. Okay. So mod of this square is A2 square plus A3 square. So similarly, without much waste of time, you can say A cross J square, that will be A1 square, A3 square. And A cross K square will be, A cross K square will be A1 square, A2 square. So add all the three. If you add all the three, the required expression becomes twice of A1 square, A2 square, A3 square, which is actually twice mod A square. Option number D is correct. How do I know? Why are you asking me? Who called him? I never call anybody. Why are you asking me that if he has got a call? I don't know. School would have called. Who called? Something. You call me after the class. Okay. Let's do some more questions. Let's take some easier ones. Okay, let's take this question. Show that the perpendicular distance of a point C from the line joining A and B. Sorry, they have missed out the word, the line. From line joining A and B. Okay, so basically this equation says that there is A and B here, okay, and there is a C point over here, okay. They're saying that this perpendicular distance is going to be this expression. Okay. Would you like to try this out or should I discuss this? Can we solve this as A cross I plus J plus K by 2? A cross this the whole square. Why? Kinshuk, why did you say that it is going to be A cross I plus J plus K modulus the square? Okay, got it. Okay. Yeah, please go ahead. Try it out. Okay. See, all of you, please understand this fact. Let me make let me go back to the fact that mod A cross B basically represents the area of a parallelogram whose adjacent sides are A and B, correct? So this area is given by mod A cross B, correct? Now, can I say, if I just half it, it will give me the area of a triangle whose two adjacent sides are A and B? Yes or no? Can I say this area will be given by half mod A cross B? Everybody agrees with me on that? Right? Okay. Now, if let's say I make a triangle whose vertices are given by ABC, that means the position vector of the vertices are ABC, then what would be the area of the triangle? So can I say area of the triangle would be half mod, take any two sides and take their cross product. Let's say I take AB and AC and take their cross product, right? Just like this formula. But remember, in this formula, A and B were side lengths or the vector representing the sides. Okay. But in this case, A, B, C are position vector of the vertices. That is the only difference between these two scenarios, right? So here I have taken the cross product of any two of the vectors representing the side, take the modulus of that and half the answer. So can I say it's half mod? What is AB vector? AB vector is B minus A. AC vector is C minus A. Correct? So let us expand this and see what happens. So this is B cross C. Okay. And this is minus B cross A. Minus B cross A is A cross B. Correct? This is minus A cross C, which is C cross A. And A cross A will anyways be a null vector. Is it not? So in short, the area of the triangle whose vertices are represented by position vector A, B, C respectively is given by this expression. Am I right? Correct? All right. Now come back to this question. If I construct a triangle over here, okay, let me call this triangle as ABC. Can I say the same situation is holding true as what it was holding when I derived this result? So can I say area of this triangle ABC will be half mod A cross B, B cross C, C cross A, correct? But area of the triangle is also given by base into height, half base into height, okay, which is D. By the way, this into is not a cross. This into is the normal multiplication into, okay? Better I would not write it because then it will create this thing, correct? So ultimately these two results should be the same. So one and two are equal results because both represent the same area of the triangle. So half mod B minus AT is half mod A cross B, B cross C, C cross A. Okay. Half gone. Okay. Divide by mod B minus A. And that's it. This is what we wanted to show, isn't it? So this is the distance, perpendicular distance of C from the line joining A and B. Of course, the order in which they have written, I have not written in the same order. I have written A cross B first, then B cross C, then C cross A. Doesn't matter. Vector addition is commutative. Okay. Is this fine? Any question, any concerns here? Okay, how else did you do it? Raghav. Oh, you couldn't do it. Okay, fine. Is this fine? So this problem basically comes This result basically comes from your understanding of the geometrical significance of mod of cross product of two vectors. Okay. Area of other figures can obviously be found out if you are baking. You're talking about area of other polygons. You can bake them in triangles and, you know, start working with the same expression. Okay. We'll take more problems, but I would now give some small break to you all because it's a continuous session. We'll have a 5 minutes break. Okay, so let's meet at 6:16 p.m. Just a 5 minute break. Okay, then I'll continue with some more problems on cross product. So just 5 minutes break, please. Let's be back in 5 minutes. Okay.